Here is the Grand Junction Science Briefing, Lifting Mechanisms for Precipitation. There are two main ingredients to make precipitation. The first is adequate moisture. The second is a mechanism or an ability or a way to lift the moisture. We will discuss five mechanisms for lift which are needed to generate precipitation in this presentation. Over the Intermountain region, the best sources of moisture are the Pacific Ocean and the Gulf of California between Baja California and Mexico. The Gulf of Mexico for the Front Range locations is very important, and we even have lake effect if you live around the Great Salt Lake in and near Salt Lake City. In this presentation, we'll focus on the five ways to lift the air which may lead to precipitation. They are dynamical lift, cyclonic lift, frontal lift, convective lift, and orographic lift. Why is lift important for precipitation? As air rises, it expands and cools. Cooler air cannot hold as much water vapor as warm air. As noted in the parcel to the right, if it continues to rise and cool, it reaches saturation. At that point, when saturation occurs, the water vapor molecules in that parcel convert to cloud droplets. Cloud droplets may grow further, depending on the lift, and form raindrops and snowflakes, which may lead to precipitation. Next, we'll talk about the types of lift, and we'll start with dynamical lift. Dynamical lift is associated with large-scale ascent over large areas. Examples include jet streaks, which are pockets of faster winds in the jet stream flow. I will show an example of the jet stream in the next slide. It also includes low-pressure storm systems, or what meteorologists call shortwave troughs in the prevailing flow. And finally, strong warm air advection events, which is where you'll see warm air increasing across an area with time, which typically occurs ahead of low-pressure systems. Here is a depiction of the upper air winds around 35,000 feet above the ground. Here we can see ridges of high pressure across the western states and over the Atlantic Ocean. We can also see a trough of low pressure over the Great Lakes region. So what is the jet stream? The jet stream is a river of swiftly moving air, sometimes exceeding 200 miles per hour, most often at high altitudes, 25,000 to 50,000 feet above the ground, which typically moves north around ridges of high pressure, where you'll find dry and generally warmer conditions, and south of the troughs of low pressure, where you'll find cool and stormier conditions. Jet streams are driven by temperature differences due to the unequal heating of the Earth. The jet streams are located where the temperature change is the greatest between the adjacent air masses, with colder air on the poleward side and warmer air towards the equator. Based on the fact that it's driven by adjacent temperature differences, the jet stream is typically farther north during the summer months and farther south during the winter months. Jet streaks are the areas of maximum winds in the jet stream, and they lead to dynamical lift. The strongest type of jet streams are the polar jets, which typically fluctuate between northern and middle latitudes. The other is the subtropical jet, which is typically higher in altitude and weaker than the polar jet, and is located across the southern and middle latitudes. Air traffic is highly dependent on the jet stream, since flight time is greatly benefited by flying in the direction of the jet stream. Air travel is usually redirected north or south rather than flying directly into the jet stream. So where do we see convergence and divergence in the upper levels? The jet stream is shown following the gray arrows. We typically see convergence of air in the upper levels of the atmosphere to the west of the trough, as denoted by the blue CON, or convergence. This convergence occurs where more air comes into the area than leaves and leads to sinking air in drier conditions at the surface on the back side of the trough of the low pressure area. Conversely, on the east side of the trough, we typically see divergence of air aloft, as shown by the blue DIV, where more air leaves or is spread out from the area. This divergence in the upper level of the atmosphere leads to rising motion and cloudy and stormy weather. An example of how divergence aloft leads to lift is shown in more detail in the next slide. So how does divergence aloft lead to dynamical lift? divergence loft of spreading out of the air in the upper levels creates a chimney effect, where air leaving the top of the column leads to upward motion in the column. So you have divergence aloft and convergence at the base, near the surface. This chimney effect can be enhanced by strong heating and convergence, the coming together of air, at the lower levels, which can occur due to surface heating or some other convergence feature at the surface. Here is a diagram showing the evolution of a storm system. The upper portion of the diagram above the red line is the weather conditions at 500 millibars, or about 18,000 feet above the ground. The lower portion of the diagram is the corresponding weather at the surface. In the left diagram, we have westerly winds at 18,000 foot level with a stationary front at the surface with cold air to the north and warm air to the south. In the middle diagram, we have a trough of low pressure in the upper levels. We have divergence of winds to the east of the trough as denoted by the red oval and convergence to the west of the trough as denoted by the blue oval. At the surface, a wave or low pressure system, as shown by the red L, has developed on the front and has now formed a cold front on the back side of the low, as indicated by the blue barbed line, and a warm front to the east of the low pressure area, as denoted by the red barbed line. Warm air moving ahead of the warm front to the east of the low will produce rising motion and lift for precipitation. In the right figure, the cold front has caught up with the warm front and has become an occluded front, which cuts off the supply of warm, moist air, causing the low pressure system to weaken. The upper level system at 18,000 feet then becomes closed off and weakens. However, since the closed low is detached from the main flow, it usually shows little movement, bringing cloudy and stormy pattern for an extended period of time to that area. Here are the circulations around a high and low pressure system. A high pressure system has clockwise circulation around it. You will find sinking air due to upper level convergence and surface divergence. Typically, dry conditions are found here. Next, we'll look at the cyclonic lift, and this occurs in a low pressure system which has counterclockwise circulation around it, with the air coming towards the center of the low. You will find rising air due to upper level divergence and surface convergence. Typically, wet conditions are found here. The next type of lift we'll talk about is frontal lift. One important fact to help understand cold fronts and warm fronts is that cold air is denser than warm air. So as the cold front moves across the area, the leading edge of cold air undercuts the warmer air mass. In a warm front environment, the warmer air is pushed over the colder air already in place well ahead of the warm front, typically to the north of the warm front. The warm front, which you see on the weather maps, is the leading edge of warm air replacing the cold air mass at the surface. So here we'll look at cold fronts in another diagram. Warm air behind the warm front is occurring to the east of the cold front on the right side of the figure. Since cold air is denser than warm air along the cold front, the warm air is abruptly lifted, resulting in heavier precipitation and possibly thunderstorms during the warmer months. Behind the cold front, the air becomes increasingly colder and drier with a switch in the prevailing wind direction to west or northwest. Here is another diagram showing a warm front. In this situation, the advancing warm air rises over the cold air mass. As it rises, the air cools and forms cloud droplets and then precipitation. The best upward forcing occurs ahead of the surface warm front. The lifting in the warm front is gradual, so generally you can expect steady, light to moderate precipitation ahead of the warm front. So to summarize the areas of lift and where you would expect to see precipitation in the storm system, we have dynamical lift due to divergence in the vicinity of the surface low pressure area, as indicated by the upward red arrows. We also have dynamical lift due to warm advection north of the warm front. We have cyclonic lift due to the counterclockwise circulation around the area of low pressure. And we also have frontal lift along and north of the warm front as the warmer air overruns the colder air at the surface. We also have frontal lift along and near the cold front where the cold air is undercutting the warm air ahead of it. Next, we'll talk about convective lift. In the previous slides, we have talked about how the atmosphere is driven by temperature differences on a horizontal scale. Here, we'll discuss temperature differences in the vertical. First, let's talk about the density of air. Cold air is denser than warm air, and a denser air parcel will sink while a lighter air parcel will rise. In very stable conditions, temperatures will increase with height. In these situations, you will have cold air at the surface and warmer air above it. An example of a very stable environment is an inversion. In unstable conditions, temperatures will decrease rapidly with height. In these situations, you will have warmer air near the surface and colder air above it. This leads to upward movement of air, which we call convective lift. Strong surface heating can lead to convective lift, which is due to an unstable atmosphere. In the presence of adequate moisture, convective lift in the spring and summer months can often lead to very heavy precipitation or even severe weather, since convective lift can generate very strong upward motions. Localized upward motion, or updrafts, of approximately 100 miles an hour can occur in the strongest storms, and these are capable of producing hail the size of softballs. Convective clouds can also occur during the winter months. Here is an example of convective clouds during the ski season at Powderhorn Mountain Resort in March. The last type of lift that we'll talk about is orographic lift. In this situation, we have stable ascent being forced by the flow over a mountain. The air will cool as it is forced over the mountain range. If the air is sufficiently moist through a deep enough layer, clouds and subsequently precipitation will occur. This is one of the reasons why we tend to see more precipitation fall over the mountain locations than in the adjacent valley floors. In summary, we need moisture and lift for precipitation. In this presentation, we have discussed the five ways to lift the air which may lead to precipitation. This concludes our science briefing, Lifting Mechanisms for Precipitation.